listing of all the SSNs, first names and class descriptions of all the classes the students are taking. If there are no class descriptions, display no descriptions of eligible things. So how would you approach that? What do you think? You know this is all about joys? Right. So how would you approach that first one?
Select SSN.
So let's not come up with the exact statement, okay? But what kind of a joy do you think you would need? Is it an inner joy? Is it an outer joy? Is it a full joy? Do we need unions? Do we need minuses? Do we need...
Does class description the main key of that table? Well, I mean, the primary key of that table, or is it? I forget whether it was that or the ID.
Well, the key of the ID is. So let's go ahead and hear from other people. What do you think about number two? Number two. How would you approach number two?
Subgroup.
Okay, give a listing of all the elements of the class code for students who are taking introduction to C programming. So you think a subquery would do now? I guess, how would you find out if a subquery is enough? How would you answer that? If it gives more than one answer back, okay. So give me something else. What other? How would you know if that's? I mean, a subquery, so we're thinking, you know, it's like some kind of select, and then, you know, the where clause, then you have another select, and there's some, yeah.
So would it be because you don't know what the class code is for introduction to C programming? So you would say, like, you know, where class code equal, or class code is select, you know, the record where the class is named at.
So you're right, there's some kind of a connection we need to make. Now, when it says give a listing of only the following, this means we want a display, right? So the display is coming to us, it's going to be the L name and the class code. So the first question that we need to be asking is, well, are they both in the same table? Are they?
No.
Is L name in the same table as class code?
Oh, yeah.
Is class code sitting in the student table?
It's in both, isn't it?
No, it's in the bridge table.
Okay, it's in the bridge table, right? So we have the student table, we have the student classes table, and we have the classes. The student table only has an ID. And the student classes has the ID and the class code. So if we have information that is coming to us from both tables, from a bunch of tables, and we need to display it, will a subquery work for us? Will that be enough? Or do we need to go into some kind of a join? We need to go into a join, right? So joining is all about expanding the table so that you get access to columns from other tables as well. Because otherwise, you can just go against one table. Otherwise, you can just go into a subquery, right? So this is saying, let's go ahead and bring in Now, for this one, how many tables do we need to go and break in? I mean, we have the L name and the class code.
So we never get.
Do we need only two tables? Do we need three tables? What do we need? Oh,
three total then?
What was that?
It would be three total then, right?
It would be three total. So do we do like a three-way join, or can we get away with like a two-way join?
You could do a two-way join with a subquery.
You could do a two-way join with a subquery, right? Because really what is going on is this L name and class code come from the two tables, right? And then being that you have the class code that's available to you, you could use that in a where clause to connect to a subquery to that other table. Why? Because that other table is the one that actually contains the description. So that's question number two. What about question number three? Give a listing of all the class descriptions and the number of students enrolled in each class for all students who are older than the average age, where the total number of students for the class is more than one. Order by the number of students. If there's no class description, replace it with other classes. Note, take it in steps. First do all those who are older than the average age, then do a goodbye, then add the having clause, and then the order, and then combine everything together. All right, so this looks pretty long. Notice that when you're looking at class descriptions and the number of students, that's what you're gonna be displaying, right? And so to display the number of students, that requires that you, what kind of
count
clause?
Count.
That's a coupon, right? So you have to go ahead and do a count, and of course being that you're displaying the class descriptions, there is a coupon involved. And it says for all the students who are older than the average age. So we're doing some filtering. Is that filtering based on anything to be grouped? Yeah, average age, right? So that's a grouping that needs to be done. And so we need to go into some filtering. And so that's where the having clause comes into play, where the total number of students for the class is more than one. Now, by the way, what about actually this one? For all the students who are older than the average age, how do you deal with that? Is that like a join or what is that? How do you arrive at that piece?
Subquery.
That's a subquery, right? Okay. So you notice that here we have some kind of a group function. Then, of course, that's going to require a group by because we have the class description. We have a subquery to go to deal with the students who are older than the average age. And then we need some kind of a having clause to go ahead and say that you're interested in this piece right there. And then, of course, there's the order by that we need to go ahead and just put everything together. And in the meanwhile, when we're displaying the class descriptions, we need to make sure that well, just in case there are no classes, then we go ahead and replace it with other classes. So just about everything is involved in this. Okay. So give a listing of all the classes for which no students are enrolled in any of the classes. And it says, look at that, use exists or not exist. Okay, so that's pretty explanatory right there. Six, create a new table that lists, that contains the list of all the students and class descriptions, including this table, the list of all the students who are not enrolled in any classes, display no classes if there are no, so there's a lot going on there. So just understanding what this question is saying. But, you know, as you're doing this, I think it's worthwhile to go ahead and maybe even get rid of the data that I have and just maybe work with your own data and consider the following scenarios. Okay, this is the student table, this is the student classes table, and this is the class table. So you have, let's say, one, John, two, Jack, three, Jill. So here we have 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, and then here we have one, let's say A, then two, and then three, C. Now, one thing that you'll recognize about this data set is that here we have Jill. That's not matching up with anything. Then you also notice that actually it's 1, 1, 1, 2, 1. You notice that these 1, 2s are matching up with this, but there is no description. And then finally, you have this 13, for which, once again, there is no match. So then this means that what you're looking at is stuff that you could do, go ahead and do data joins with. There's stuff also that you could go ahead and do outer joins with. Yes? So like this one would be an outer join, that one would be an outer join. The stuff that we have in here, all of this, would be involved in the inner join. And so what I'm going to go ahead and ask you at some point is to go ahead and pick up Jill, or to pick up the 13, or to go ahead and pick up this one right here and replace that with something. So, if there are no class descriptions, so there's that. Anyway, and I want to tell you to use a combination of inner join, you need the minus, so you can think about it. See how you want to approach that. And it says repeat question number six, using a combination of inner join, union, and not exist. And so that should tell you that, you know what, this piece is the same, that piece is the same. But I guess you'd be replacing the minus with the not exist. Then you're going to be creating a view. And you want to go and find out the courses that each student is not involved in. So I tell you a Cartesian product. Well, you won't sure you know what the heck is that. Okay, so there's some answers there. So we won't worry about that. We'll just skip up. Okay, so there it is. That was a very quick swim. All right. Okay, so we have that. And then question number 10 is going to go ahead and deal with system tables. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and make that available to you. Okay, so start working on it. And then we can go ahead and take a look at any challenges that come. Okay. All right, so anything before I close this?
It's not due Wednesday, is it?
No. This is going to go ahead and take a little longer. So we're going to go ahead and just allow you, maybe a week, we can have, to get this.
So like next Wednesday?
So let's see here. So we have this week. We have next week, and then we have the week after, right? Is that another one? So we have
the week 15.
Yeah.
Are those 16 weeks of the semester? I'm not sure.
Yeah, so I think we have 3 weeks of lecture left, including this week. So I think, by next week, we should be able to go ahead and get this done. So that'll be okay. All right, so we can close this. So today, what I want you to do is to go ahead and talk about something else. So let's go ahead and find out what that something else is. I think this is another one of those good quotes. Okay, we're going to use it again. We're going to talk about this. Marriages are made in heaven, but then again, so are thunder and lightning. So there's that. Okay. So, let's go ahead and talk about how Oracle sort of keeps track of what it's doing. So we said that whenever you create a table, whenever you create a column, do any of this stuff, create constraints, Oracle is actually putting some kind of an entry into its own tables. And so look at that, we have all these different tables that have all kinds of information. Now, there's something kind of interesting. Now, these tables have different names, okay? But what's interesting is that there are some of these tables that actually have the all underscores of weakness. There are others who have the DB underscore. And then there are still yet others that have the user underscore, which I haven't put in here. Oh, there is user. Okay. So, I think what is going on is you have a table, for example, called DBA underscore tables. You have user tables, and you have all. That's actually pretty cool. Okay, so all underscore tables, okay? So these are all, like, all these tables, okay, that you can get a hold of. But the question is, what in the world is going on with all these prefixes? That is, well, anyway, so the question is why? What is going on? You know, we haven't really played with privileges like Oracle, but with Oracle, you're able to go ahead and just take these tables, take all the stuff that we're creating, and you can say, you know what, we'd like to go ahead and give a certain privilege. Now, so this is how it works. If I go ahead and create a table, so I log in as Raj, okay, and I create a table, and so the tables that I've created, I can go to user underscore tables because tables, user underscore views, user underscore constraints, so the prefix user comes into play. Now, it's very possible that I may create something as a user, and I may say, you know what, I'd like you to also go ahead and start, you know, having access to it. So, the all underscore is going to go ahead and show you all the tables that you've created, plus all the tables that you've been given access to, okay, by other people who created those tables. And then you have the DBA, okay? And of course the DBA is kind of like God, okay? They have access to everything. And all the tables that anyone has created, and no one needs to give a permission, they just have permission to everything. So those are the three different categories of tables. Now you will find that when you look at, for example, something like user tables underscore, user underscore tables, DBA underscore tables, all underscore tables, they all have the same structure. They have the same exact columns. When you look at it, it doesn't make any difference, except that, once again, they just have different kinds of information that are made available depending on the privileges. Okay. Now, let's go ahead and take a look at this. So at this point, you have this table. You have table patients, and you have table disease. So what I want to go ahead and do here is go in here. And let's go ahead and just start populating our system table. So the table that I'm interested in is user constraints. So user constraints has got this thing called table name. Constraints. So we have a table patients. And table patient has got this constraint name, PPID PK. We'll just say P patient ID PK. And then it's a primary key, so it's constraint type this name. So here's that. Then let's see what other constraints we have, okay? So in the same table patient, we have a constraint for gender that's called patient gender check. And then there's this condition, and that condition is going to be the check condition, which is gender in and format. Then we have, once again, in the patient table, we have just some constraint, sys, like 001, because it doesn't actually have a name. It's a check condition. And then we'll just say that it just says salary greater than 10,000. All right, and then we also have a unique constraint in this table. Patient. And it doesn't have a name, so we'll just say sys002. And its constraint is you. This one right here might be a check constraint, that's another check constraint. Okay, so that's really pretty much it. Now, then we come here. We also have the patient deceased. And the patient disease table that says it references patient. So we have a primary, we have a foreign key that has been created here. So let's go and notice that this foreign key has not been given a name. So we have sys003. And it's a foreign key, and when you have a foreign key, what is the constraint type that we use for it?
R.
R. Now, this foreign key is connecting to the patient table, correct? But what in the patient table is it connecting to? So this patient ID in the patient disease is connecting to what?
Patient ID.
It's connecting to patient ID in the patient table, correct? And what is the patient ID in the patient table? Is that a constraint? It's a primary key, okay? What is the name of that constraint?
PAT.ID.PK.
Yes. So in the table patient, which we are referencing, so patient disease is referencing the patient table, and we're going to go to the primary key, and that primary key has a name. And so we're going to go ahead and put that right. Do you see that? Okay. So that's what the R is for. It pertains to that R right here. But now, when you look at this, you notice that there's an issue. And the issue that we have is that if I want to go and find out the columns make up my primary key or my foreign key, I have no idea. How do I find out where that information is, where that information is? So, here, it just tells me that it's just the primary key, but that's it. I don't have any additional information. So it just so happens that aside from this table user constraints, there's another table that we want, and that is user cons. And the user cons column table, it's got table name, constraints, name, and column. So there is the table patient, and we have patients, ID, EK. So what is the call that makes up the primary key in that patient table? It's the patient ID, right? Okay, so there's that. There's also this unique constraint, right? And so there's patients, and that's a sys002. And what are the columns that actually make that? Oh, we have a primary key here that we didn't count. Right? So that's F name and L name. Now, there's also a patient disease. Okay, all right, okay. So there's also a patient disease. And there was a... There was this primary key in there as well, okay? This one. So... So you notice that all the columns that make up the that make up this constraint, they're all right there. Now let's go with this other one, which is this this one right here. So this one is patient disease, sys003. So I'm looking at this one. And I'd like to go and find out what is my foreign key. So in this table, what is my foreign key? Which column is my foreign key?
Patient ID.
Patient ID. So right here, hotel. That's my foreign key. So then in here, I'm going to go and say, it's my patient ID. All right. And then finally, we're going to go ahead and do this patient disease again. And that is a sys004. And so it's primary keys made up of patient ID and patient disease sys004. And that is disease. So this was more of a unique constraint. This one right here was for the primary key. This one is for the foreign key. And this one right here is for the primary key. Okay, that is what's going on. Now, let's just imagine here that I ask you, so what are the columns that actually make up the primary key for the patient table? How do you arrive at that, knowing what we know about all this? So let's go ahead and hear from someone who would like to go ahead and say something about this. Yes, what do you think? So once again, we'd like to go ahead and find out all the columns that make up the primary. This is your. Okay, so we're joining these two tables. Yes?
Yeah, because you both have constraint name.
Okay, and so you're saying, let's go ahead and connect that with this. Because so that you have some kind of an inner joint. Right? You got that?
Yeah, because then you could get it to show.
Okay.
Sort which one.
So what would that primary key, I mean, what would that syntax begin to look like? So we're going to go ahead and just include user constraints and user const columns. And apparently there's some kind of a natural join that's taking place, right? Because the call manager is back and say, do you need anything else in the work laws that you need to consider?
Where? You need to use where on the table name.
Okay.
So you're not grabbing all of your tables.
Right. So I'm specifically interested in the patient table, and I'm specifically interested in where the constraint type is.
He.
Yes? Okay, so that makes sense. The constraint, this inner join, along with this wear condition. So we have the join and we have all that. Okay, let's go ahead and find out. Now, would that work with even composite primary keys? It would, right? So let's just say that I'm interested in looking at what makes up the primary key for patient disease. So notice that I don't really want to know about the constraint names. That's just something that's not in my disease. So I say, hey, patient disease, I'm interested in your primary key. So then it's going to go and return to me that constraint name. I feed that constraint name, or I connect that constraint name with anything that has a sys004, which is this piece right here. And then, so it's going to go and display patient ID and disease. Okay, so that's good, yes? What about if you want to go and get a hold of the foreign key? How do you get a hold of the foreign key? What do you think? Let's go and hear from someone. Table that foreign key is in. So we say that we are interested in R and we are specifically interested in patient disease. Right? And so that gives us access to this row. Then we
do a natural join.
Well, so if we do a natural join, that would actually go ahead and say sys003. Yes? And so we find the sys003, which is this one. And it says, hey, patient disease, you have a foreign key and it's patient ID. Yeah? But then how do we know what it's connected to? Because the foreign key has a connection to something else, right? So what do we do after that? So we have one part of the foreign key. Which is the column in the chart table. This one right here?
Yes.
So we need to go ahead and connect that to the constraint name as well. Okay. So then, now, would that be like an and clause, or would that be like an or clause? What are we looking at? I mean, so you have a where condition, and you're trying to make a connection. So you're saying, okay, so we have this join condition, you connect, so you have this join where you're interested in user constraints and user const calls. You said in your where condition that you're specifically interested in patient disease, where the constraint type is R. So that's an and, right? Okay, and then you want to go ahead and connect our columns now. So you're saying let's go ahead and connect this column to constraint name. So the constraint name in here is going to be connected to constraint name there. But then you said that the constraint name here also needs to be connected with this as well. Right? So now, was that an and that we need? That is, we need to go ahead and include this and that, or is it or?
Or.
Is it, it's or. Now, why do you say or?
If you choose and, they can't both be in the same row.
Okay, all right, so it's got to be or, which is saying, but you know what? If you find a match with sys003, let's go ahead and find out what that column is. Okay, fine. But also, if you go ahead and come up with this one right here, let's go ahead and find out what column that's in. And so that would actually be going to give us the PK, which is this piece right here. Now then, the other piece is that we want to go ahead and find out what tables are interested in this connection. So how do we grab that information? Because I need to go ahead and say, I need to know that patient disease is connecting to the patient table. So where do we get that information? So we know that that information about tables is sitting in a table name, right?
Yes.
Okay. Now the question is, does it make any difference whether I go to this table name or that table name, or is it all the same?
No, it'd be different. You want the table name
at
the bottom.
For the bottom one? Now, why would you say the bottom? So you're suggesting that, you know, if we are on this row, with regards to this row, whether you're looking at this constraint or that constraint, the table name is always patient disease. So that's not what we want. We need it to be different. So now if we go in here, for CIS-003, the table name is patient disease. But for patient IDPK, the table name is this. Which means that we get patient disease here connected to the patient data, so we get all of that information. Yeah? Are you with me on that? Just confirm. Yes?
Yeah. I get what you're saying, but I'm not following how you're getting there. It makes sense.
Okay. So tell me, at what point did you get it? So do you understand that we have a starting in place? And the starting place is that we're going to go to the user constraint table. And we are interested in the foreign key, which means that for a specific table, which means that we go and identify the table that we're interested in.
Yep.
Right? And then because it's a foreign key, we understand it's an all.
Yep.
Okay? So then we also understand that we have these two pieces that we are interested in. Because CIS-003 is connecting to patient IDPK. Right? Because CIS-003 is what? Patient ID. And patient IDPK, that's patient ID. So the patient ID in the patient table is connecting to the patient ID in the patient disease table.
Mm-hmm.
So that part of it, you sort of get, right?
Yeah.
So you also understand that since we're trying to go ahead and match up these constraint names that we have with this constraint, and this actually has to go ahead and match up here, that also has to match up here with that. Because if we can go ahead and match up this piece with some row in here, then we can go to the column and grab the columns themselves. So patient ID PK, if I can find that, then I'd be able to go and get that patient ID. The CIS-003, if I can grab that, I'm able to go and grab the patient ID. And the foreign key in this case is a patient ID connected to another patient ID. And then we said that we want to go ahead and use the OR clause, because for this, we find a match, we display it, or for this, we find a match and we display it. And then the final point that we made is that the table name should not come from here. Because if you are stuck on that row, which contains all of your information, the table name is all the same. But I need to go and say that patient ID, the patient disease table, is connecting to patient ID, the patient table. Well, where's that coming from? Well, if I've connected the CIS-003 to this table, the table name is patient disease. If I also connect patient ID PK to this constraint name, the table is patient. So then I'm able to go and say that patient ID in the patient table is connecting to patient ID in the patient disease group.
Okay.
And that's why we need to go ahead and use the table name here as opposed to that table. So, I know that there's quite a bit there. So anyway, just go forward a bit and see what happens. Now, just in case what I told you is becoming confusing, it just so happens that look at that. Now, the only reason why I went ahead and did it so slowly is because I knew that if I just showed this to you immediately, maybe it wouldn't make any sense. But you notice that here we have the R constraint name, here we have the constraint name, and so connect that and that to this. And then look at that, there's that on. So that's exactly this thing that we were talking about. Now, what is interesting about this is that, let's say that we are interested in indexes. You know, when creating an index, how do you create an index? What is that syntax called? It's been a while, I think. But,
create index of name. Yeah. I can't remember how you set which table it's focused on, but I know the end is on.
So you need to identify the table name and then the column names that are going to be involved in the index. It could be 1, 2, 3, whatever, right? So the question that actually comes up, okay, is, well, how do you actually go ahead and find out with regards to indexes what columns make up an index? You see, it's the same question that one could actually ask with regards to primary key. If you have a primary key, well, what columns actually make up the primary key? If you have a unique key, what columns make up the unique key? In this case, we're saying, if you have an index, what columns make up the index? And now, how is Oracle dealing with this? Well, when we were looking at the primary key, and we wanted to go and find out the columns that make up the primary key, we said, you know what? You go to user constraints. And all the column information is in user columns, right? Isn't that the way we did it? We said you need to, this is where all the details are, and this is where the parent records are. It's kind of like the patient and the patient disease. So you identify the patient one time, but all the stuff about the patient, all the diseases, the many diseases the patient has, it's all right there. Or the same thing is true with students. You define the student, and all the games or all the courses the student is involved in is right there. Well, why am I telling you this? Well, because when it comes to indexes, it's the same scheme. You have a table name called user indexes, and then guess what? If you want to go and find out what columns make up an index, it's user in columns. It's the exact same thing. So if you understood what you just talked about when it comes to primary keys, it's that exact same thing that you would actually go and do with user indexes. You would just go and connect these two tables to go and find out what those columns are. Yeah. And then, of course, we know that when you go and create a primary key, automatically an index will be created for you. When you create a unique key, automatically an index is going to be created for you. And so what you'll find is that whatever the constraint name is that you go ahead and deal with regards to a primary key, the constraint name or the index name would be exactly the same. So if in here we have like patient ID PK, that was our constraint name here in the user constraints table. It just so happens that we go to the user indexes, we have a column called index name, And that index name will be, again, the same nation ID PK. Those names are identical. Yeah. There it is, user indexes, user name columns, so that's what's going on. And so there's the user views. All right, so what do you think? Let's go ahead and see what is involved in this. So let's go ahead and go with the folks from the back, and then we'll come forward, okay? All right, so identify the name of all the check-in screens that the person did. What would that syntax look like?
Do we have to select something from the system table?
Do we have to select something from where?
System table?
Yeah, so this is all about system tables.
Yeah.
Constraint type?
Constraint type, well, we already know it's a check condition, right? We know it's a check constraint, and so we know what that constraint type is. So we don't really need to see the constraint type. But what if you want to go and find out exactly what makes up that check condition? Like, for example, the salary being greater than 10,000. What is the call that contains that condition?
Check type.
Check condition?
Type.
Check condition, check that. Okay, so check condition's got the details. All right, and then what?
Then from person?
From person, is it?
In the person table.
User constraints.
From user constraints.
Check condition is not null.
And is that what we want, or is there something else? Okay, so what we did say, table name is person.
Constraint type.
And constraints type equals to
C.
Is there a reason that check condition is not null wouldn't work? Because there would only be a value in ones that are check constraints, right?
Oh, where the check condition is not equal to null?
Yeah.
It's not null.
It's not null.
You know, I assume that you'd be right, because if it's got something in it, then that would mean it's a check condition. It's a very odd way of doing it, but certainly I think it would work. Yeah. Okay, so there's that. So identify the name of the primary key and the unique key in the person table. So let's go ahead and go to, Joseph, how are you doing? I see you're busy. What do you think about number two? Identify the name of the primary key and unique key in the person table. I guess that's a no. All right, we'll come to the first one. Got it.
No, it's just happened to be like super overwhelming. I'm not good.
Okay, take it easy. All right, okay. All right. Yes, go ahead.
Select. Constraint name?
Constraint name, okay. So all we're looking for is just a name.
Oh.
Okay.
From user constraints. Where table name person? Where
table.
I'm not sure.
Table name equals a person. Okay, so that's good. And then anything else? So we're interested in specifically the primary key and the unique key.
And constraint type equals you.
How about in?
Oh, in. Yeah.
And then what are the two constraint types?
In you have
P. And you. Yeah?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. All right. So it says we are looking for just the name of the constraint name and the unconstrained name for the foreign key.
Question.
Yeah.
Would it be helpful to select constraint name and constraint type so you know which is primary?
Oh, yeah. So you know which one is which.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. That makes sense. And then what about this one? Identify both constraint name and unconstrained name for the foreign key. So let's go ahead and I guess we'll come to you, sir. Yes?
Select constraint name, comma, R constraint from user constraint columns.
Now, do we want to go to user const columns or just user constraints?
Just user constraints.
Just user constraints, okay, because we're not looking for any column information. We just want to get a hold of, and just going back to this diagram that we had, so we're just looking for this piece and that piece, and they're both sitting in that table. Okay, so user constraints, is there anything else?
Where constraint type equals R.
Where constraint type equals to R. And then what else? Now do we want it for all the tables, or are we specifically interested in the foreign key for one table? Who's the foreign key? We have person and personality. Who's got the foreign key? Personality? Is it personality or is it person?
Person.
It would be a person, right? Because what is going on is, you know, you have this person, and so let's just say we have John, he's got personality one. Jack, personality one. And then one is like good. So what is the foreign key? And this is like person 1-1, person 1-2. So this one right here is connecting to that one right there. Yes? So this is right there, the foreign key. Is it? Because this is just going to go ahead and give you a listing of all the personalities, 2, bad, 3, whatever. But you just go ahead and identify the personalities one time. This is where the child is, because that personality type will be repeated for many folks. So if that is the case, we say constraint type equals to R, and then what else? And what? Because this is going to go and give it to us at this point for all the tables. Which table are we using?
Table equals person.
Table name. To person. because that's where the foreign key is. When you're looking at the person at the personality table, you install the foreign key in the person table. Okay, now identify the calls that make up the primary key constraint. All right, so then let's go ahead. Well, since you've already participated, we'll go to the individual who's sitting right behind Shane, who has a laptop open. How you doing?
Good, how are you?
Isn't this great? You don't know anybody's name here, and so we have to use all this other stuff. So give it to us.
Always struggle.
Okay, so it's not happening to you?
No.
All right.
Unfortunately not.
All right, so then you've already said something, Shane. You've already said something. And then, yes, sir, what do you think? Okay, so we're looking to identify the call and make up the primary constraint. Select call name. So the constraint, the call names are all right there. Yeah? Okay, so so that's in this table right there. But then, if we're interested in the primary key, how do we know about whether it's a primary key or not? We have to go here and look at that type. Yeah? So what do we need to do? I guess we'll come down to you, sir. What do you think?
I think we have to select the constraint type from user constraints and the user calls.
Okay, so you're suggesting we do what? So what changes do you want to make here?
I guess add the constraint type.
You want the constraint type, so you have a wire condition?
Maybe add the constraint type to the select statement, and then add the user const.
Oh, so you're saying, so let's go and make that UC, and then you're saying user const columns, mm-hmm. UCC, okay. So there's something that needs to be done, right? And so there's a connection that apparently needs to be made. Now, whatever we come up with here, identify the name of all the indexes of the person table. So let's just let this one be, and you can think about it. Let's go with this one. Identify all the indexes for the person table. How do we do that? I guess we'll just come all the way over here to user. Yes. Yeah. So how do we identify all the indexes? Where are the indexes? Which table has it?
The maybe user columns?
User cons columns. So we're looking for just the index names. So what table has just the index names? So we'll come down to the person sitting in front of you. Yes, please.
User and columns.
Yeah. What is it?
Called indexes.
Yeah, it's not on that one. It's on a different.
Oh, so like the next label is just the index name.
Table.
It's another slide.
Oh, yeah.
When?
It's all basically the same, just for indexes. So it's pretty much the same exact thing.
Person? Yes?
Shit.
Okay. And then this other one. Apparently there's some kind of join. So you can think about that and see how to use these. So we're going to go ahead and give you a quick assignment out there. It's about system tables. So that will be available to you. All right, does anyone have any questions? No questions? Well, I think we can say we are good. Okay. Yeah. All right.
Sets. For that one right there, were you supposed to say like user constraints UC and then space user const columns, I don't know, CC, where the, let's see, where they equal each other basically, you're going to say where column name equals, like UC's column name equals CC's column name?
No, because you don't have column names in both tables. You don't have column names in the UC table.
A constraint. Oh, no. Constraint name.
Oh, constraint name.
Yeah.
Okay. So what you have a constraint name matchup.
Where the constraint name equals the constraint name. Sorry.
And then you need anything else?
Well, I would have joined the two tables from after the from statement.
Okay.
So I would have said user constraint UC, like call it UC and then call them, and the next one would be user const constraints, I just call it CC, and then where UC's column name equals CC's column name. Constraint name, sorry.
UC constraint name equals to back constraint name.
Yes.
And then what else?
I can't remember the rest of the parameters of the question.
So you're interested in a specific table, right?
Identify
the call to make up the primary key constraint.
I need to say where the constraint type is P.
Yeah. Yeah.
I kind of had it, but.
No, that's good. That's good. Yes. Well, you know, I think it's worth playing.